project is Flagration. So to start off, our outline is, we will talk about transportation is, we'll start off with the team members, our motivation for the project, description of the project and impact on society, system requirements, the need identification, system description, key module description, risk analysis, test planning, project schedule, our 40% milestone, our bill of materials, conclusion and future work, standards, and reference issues. So we have Vincent Seta, we have Stanley Wong, Jack, and me, Zach. So for project motivation, our idea was during hiking, personal hiking, backpacking, excursions, many type of issues are encountered. One issue that arises is the inability to keep track of water supply. With hydration pack being stuffed into the pack, it wouldn't be easy to take it out and check the water contents constantly. So being worried about the water left in the reservoir pack or trying to figure out how often to stay hydrated can be a hassle. It is very easy to become dehydrated during long trips, especially if it is difficult to monitor your water intake. And this inspired our idea for Flagration. Accurately keeping track of water consumption and current water levels will dramatically improve these experiences. So for our project description, a major issue that occurs during intense, long-distance, exerted trips is dehydration. With our products, the user will be able to monitor their water intake and track their personalized hydration plan. With a synchronized app on the phone, consumers can plan out their trip and track at what rate they are consuming water versus what is recommended. And during this, helpful LED alerts will go off when your water consumption is too high or too low. This allows consumers to stay healthy and hydrated during endeavors. And with keeping all this in mind, we designed our Flagration to be used for runners and cyclists, hikers and backpackers, and military personnel.
So these are some of the system requirements. We found that it must be lightweight and compact, accurately measure water flow, have a long battery life, be easy to use. It must be able to mechanically function without power so that if it does die during a hike or a trip, you can still drink water from it. Must also be able to measure the amount of remaining water and synchronize the application. This is a simple chart on each of the applications. We found that it must be very easy to use. That's one of the main purposes here. The size of it is also extremely important because a lot of times backpackers and hikers measure every single little ounce. And then the most important is the accuracy, which has been past attempts at this sort of project, and eventually they were called back because it was so inaccurate, so we might want to try to focus on this. And that problem statement said hydration packs don't allow the user to easily gauge the amount of water remaining. This is the dehydration. This is our engineering trade-off matrix. We analyzed a lot of different types of flow meters and water flow measuring technologies. Three that we found to be most viable would be the electric pump, which is definitely the highest in accuracy, and the pneumatic flow meter, turbine flow meter. What we found is that even though the accuracy of the electric pump was so high, even though we were focusing on accuracy across, the other aspects of it were so poor that eventually we decided to go with really a combination of identical meter, turbine flow meter, called the Hall effect.
So some of the risks with this project is, one is the inaccuracy of flow meters. We're trying to make sure that the accuracy is good because of the past products that have been recalled due to inaccuracy. So we would most likely be trying to measure the volume of water that we're intaking and try to see what we measure as opposed to the actual measurement of the water. And we'll try to, from this data, we'll try to do some correction in making it more accurate. Another risk would be long lead items and deliveries. A lot of these products, you can find them cheap in China, but it takes time and forever. So we try to make them. We would look into the description from the manufacturers and contact them. are the lead times of items. Another one will be easily breakable. Since these items are being used outdoors, we want to try to keep it rugged, or in case someone actually like, maybe drops it, or if they trip and fall on it, we don't want it to just break in an instant. Another one would be if it alters the taste of the water, since we're passing water through our meters. It might actually alter the taste from metals or plastics. So if we do sense that it does alter the taste, we might actually move towards food grade meters and different sensors to ensure that there is no taste, but it might drive cost up. And one of the risks that we will not be able to control will be using incorrectly inputs data, since our meter measures the amount of water that's being intake from the user, but the user itself has to put in the settings of the meter of how much water they filled up in their reservoir. That might be, they might accidentally fill it up as 31 ounces, and they might input 32 ounces, so it might throw off our apps or other measuring tools. So what we're trying to do is make the settings very, very easy to use and put easily readable, use mobile applications and graphical interfaces to prevent incorrect data. So in system description, we have two pieces to our system, which is a flow meter and another device. The flow meter will record the amount of water that the user has drank, and it will take input from the user about how much water they actually filled into their reservoir. We have Bluetooth communication, a battery for quick charge and battery for portability, and provides a gauge of the amount of water left in the reservoir, which is the main goal of this. We would take input from the sensor and pass it on, and from the mobile end, we would actually have it connect with the flow meter. And one of the things is we might actually have more advanced settings in our mobile app so that users can see it, instead of a little screen, a little 16x2 LCD screen from the user. So we'll be able to input settings easily using their mobile device. And another one that we might try to implement is calculation data, recording data from your water intake, so that the user is able to analyze how much water they're taking in from their height, which they might be able to use for future hikes to maximize their power. So for hardware, we had to begin instruction of our hardware. As you can see, there's a LCD screen, a Bluetooth device, and a flow meter. Right now, these are kind of big that we've noticed. We look at the specification and we assume that the centimeters could be a lot smaller than we think. So right now, it's more of a prototyping phase, and as we go on, after we complete this, we wanted to make a general instruction so that we can hand it off to our software designers to be able to more interact with our meter, and then we'll probably start optimizing and improving some of these parts to make it a smaller package for the user. So this is the layout of the microcontroller. We have about 4 LEDs, one for Bluetooth and 3 for indications of how much water you have left in the reservoir. We have 4 buttons, 2 for settings, 2 wheel off settings, 1 wheel out for Bluetooth, and we left a spare there just in case we ever need it for a different setting. The microcontroller that we're using is a PIC16F877A, which is just a 16-bit microcontroller. It does not have an internal clock, so we have to actually purchase and create an external clock. We're using a 4 megahertz oscillator, which we find is not the amount of signal and sampling rate that we need. And the rest is just a flow meter, an LCD screen, Bluetooth connected to the USR.
For the software aspect of this project, we're working with MPLED X-IBE. This program allows us to work directly with our microchip. Is actually from the same company, with our microcontroller, this is they're actually from the same company. With the MPLAB X, we're allowed to work with several different debuggers. The one that we found the most useful was the Picket 3. This works easily with the microcontroller. and is actually most commonly found. Actually, when also coding with MPLABX, you're allowed to choose your compiler system. And for this, we're working with C, and while coding with C, we're coding the Bluetooth module, the LCD, flow meter, push buttons, and the LEDs. For the Bluetooth module, it uses USR, terminals to transmit and receive data bits through Bluetooth communication. The Bluetooth will be used to send outputted data from the other modules to the cell phone application. It will also receive data from the cell phone application and send it to the LCD module. This could be from, instead of entering everything, as Stanley said before, onto the small 16x2, you can go onto your application, enter your height distance, you can enter the amount of water you have in your reservoir, if there's other places to fill up, and that will all use a program to calculate your hydration plan, when you should be hydrating and how often, to make sure your water lasts the entirety of the trip. Next, we will be talking about the LCD, which will be connected to most of the modules. We'll take outputs from functions using calls, then displaying the values onto the LCD, such as your current water intake, what you should be intaking, and how much water you have left. An LCD library is given by MPLABX, so pin planning is done for each microcontroller already. All that is needed for the main function code, which includes the cursor command, which pinpoints where on the LCD you're printing, and the print command, which actually prints our information. The flow meter will calculate time interval between the pulses to calculate the flow rate of the water. When the flow button is pushed for the flow meter, our program will be launched, and this will then take the calculated time intervals and output how much water is left in the reservoir by subtracting current amounts. Push buttons. One push button will be directly connected to the Bluetooth module, which is used for pairing, like you see on both Bluetooth devices. The other two push buttons will be used to set data values on the LCD screen, so basically your interval up, interval down, so that if you don't have access to your application, you are still able to enter things straight into the LCD. And finally, we have the LEDs, which will be programmed to turn on when certain values are reached a threshold. So you have a lot of water, a green LED will blink every now and then, you have a minimum amount of water, you'll see a yellow LED that will blink every now and then, and a red LED that will blink every now and then when you're low on water. There's also a blue LED that will blink when you're initially pairing. For the test plan, we're currently do unit testing, since it's still somewhat in the early stages. Right now, we're making sure we have each part tested and we can fully understand what's going on. This is basically, we're just trying to learn the basic functionalities of the microcontroller, the outputs, the inputs, like the LCD screen, the Bluetooth module, the flow sensor, buttons and LEDs. We actually have a video later on that shows that we started learning the functionalities of the microcontroller very simple code where we just push in a button and LED activates. Next we'll be focusing on integration testing. This is more when the app comes into play, how it will interface directly with our module and our mouthpiece, how data will send back and forth via Bluetooth. Finally, the acceptance test, which is the final testing to make sure everything runs smoothly.
So the project plan that we have, plan to have all of the engineering, which is the design, done by December 4th. Then we will begin delivery. We allocated about two to three weeks for that, since sometimes it might actually take a little longer to get our items. Then we went over to constructing, which we got to begin around January. We're going to go ahead and we gave it up to, we have enough time to deliver. We will actually have the bulk will be testing and coding, which we will start during the spring semester and finally completing the project at that division. So the go, no go milestones, we have completed the order of material, the bill of material, and we've completed a circuit design schematic. We have begun preliminary construction of our total flow meter. What is not completed is the coding and the testing, which is back to back and it's going to take a little bit. So this is a quick video to demonstrate what we have currently of the testing.
So,
you
passed by the picket three, which is debugging, and this is the simple code to show that we're able to use the picket three to show basic instructions to the microcontroller.
And just doing an input and introducing. is our little materials and cost analysis. For we wanted to choose the microcontroller because the one that instead of using an Arduino Raspberry Pi, since we wanted to make a smaller size, which Arduino Raspberry Pi would not be able to give it to us for the price. So we tried to use a microcontroller that only cost about $5. And we had to purchase a total board for prototyping to create that simple prototype, like mobile, instead of having a breadboard. We had to get a 4 meter, which is $10, which was one of the big purchases. Bluetooth module, push button valve, LCD screen, LEDs, switches, buttons, and possibly a crystal. So grand total came out to about $47.34. This is not taking into account all of the that we were to purchase in bulk, which probably lowered this price. And we would look to after the hardware has been completed and handed off to the software engineers to begin their coding and interacting with the flow meter. We would have the hardware team actually try to optimize some of these parts and research into cheaper parts and smaller parts that would be better for the team.
And so for our conclusion and the future work that we plan on is, as of right now, we have the beginning stages of the project, which is learning how to use the microcontroller with the other parts. Future work includes, obviously, learning how to use the LCD screen for display, the Bluetooth driver, and creating a mobile app for storing and creating settings. And then also improving the initial design and creating a power supply for the overall project. These are some of the standards we found that would be used during our project.
This idea. There's nothing more frustrating than being on a long hot hike and partway through to trying to suck on the tube of the camelback and not being satisfied there. So a little bit concerned about the practicality of manually plugging in the amount of water I'm adding. Right? So sometimes that works out. Normally, if I'm backpacking, I use a filter. Some friends have a stirry pin, and we might do that in nice Nalgene and be able to measure the amount of water put in. But if I'm pumping the filter out of a stream, I'm getting power up. So have you thought about some alternatives there, or any way to handle
that? They can always add a sensor to the bottom. They can actually keep track of what you put in. I know I've personally gone backpacking, hiking multiple times. I have 3 different reservoirs and all actually have the level meters too. So I mean, after you pump, you can always take a look before you step back in and then enter it. To enter it would be real quick on the LCD. You just hold one button and then it will just tap and hold the button again and it would be able to register. But we can always add another flow meter on the bottom that could keep track of how much water you pump in as well.
Think about a little strain gauge. Type of thing to hang it like a fish scale type thing, but read out electronically because you know exactly what the weight of the water is.
Okay.
And you can translate, you have a little bit of a baseline for the weight of the bladder. And I think you can get a pretty accurate reading that way. You just hang it for a second, press a button, and have a program.
Why did the new edition go for us to trade the flow meter?
The price.
It's a lot of money.
Yeah.
That's money.
You said there would be a pump in your design. Would that pump the water into the wearer's mouth?
No, not anymore. The original concept was actually thinking of using a pump, an electric pump, because that would most accurately measure how much water is going through, because it has a constant pressure. But we decided that this wasn't the best route because, say, worst case scenario, it does die while you're out. Then you won't be able to drink your water without the electricity. So we felt that a mechanical pump was the best way to go, like a push button valve. So you click the push button, which allows flow, and then you begin drinking. And that felt like the most accurate way. So, anyone else?